just a prayer away. All you need to do is call. He will hear your faintest cry. He's concerned about you. So while your tears are flowing through your time of mourning, He is here to lift your heavy heart, 'cause He's in love with you. He knows, He cares, He sees, He's there. He'll carry you. He's concerned. But the morning will bring joy. He won't give you more than you can bear. He's concerned about you. He loves you. Oh, yes. He loves you. Oh, He loves you. I know He does. He's concerned about you. He knows, He cares, He sees, He's there. He'll carry you. God is just a prayer away. All you need to do is call. He will hear your faintest cry. He's concerned about you. So while your tears are flowing through your time of mourning, He is here to lift your heavy heart, 'cause He's in love with you. He knows, He cares, He sees, He's there. He'll carry you. concern about you. He knows, he cares, he sees, he's there, and he'll carry you. He's concerned about you.
I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And whosoever lives and believes in me shall never die. The hour is coming, and now is, when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. We brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we shall carry nothing out. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. If we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord. So then whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lives again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. Our Savior, Christ Jesus, abolished death and brought life and immortality to light. I am the first and the last. I am he who lives and was dead. And behold, I am alive forevermore. And I have the keys of death and of hell. Because I live, you will live also. And death shall be no more, neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain. For the first things are passed away. We begin our life of celebration as we sing a hymn, 40, All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name.
Oh,
Please be seated. Let us pray. Most gracious God, we turn to you in the sorrow and grief of our bereavement, praying that we may find the strength we need in your sustaining grace, so that even as we mourn the death of one whom we knew and loved, we may not be overcome by this trial, but we may hold fast, trusting in your goodness and mercy. Assure us, O Lord our God, that death is not the end of those who trust in you. And may our hearts be so composed in the Holy Spirit that all fear and bitterness may be swallowed up in the light and peace you give to your troubled children. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Almighty and eternal God, who by the Holy Spirit minister to us in our weakness, and by the victory of your Son, Jesus Christ, have given us the pledge of eternal life, lift us, we pray, above our present distress and sorrow, and shed the light of your grace and glory upon us, through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. My brothers and sisters, we are met in this solemn moment to commend our sister, Virginia Imelda Bryan, into the hands of the Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Redeemer, by whose stripes we are healed, and in whose name alone we have salvation. Let us then recall to mind the life of our dear sister as we hear tributes. Receive a solo, sung by Shanika Roach, and afterwards we'll have the eulogy. So we give our attention to the tribute by Mr. Mervyn Moore, solo by Shanika Roach, and then we have our eulogy by Mr. Merton Moore. Mervyn.
Good morning. Thanks for being here. Thanks to my family that traveled so far to be a part of this send-off for my wonderful friend. Before I get into the praises that I have for Aunt Mel's, I'd just like to read you a poem. This poem was composed over the past week. One of Aunt Mel's dearest friends, she lives in West Haven, Florida. Of course, she's close to Aunt Mel's age, so traveling would be a challenge, and she couldn't make it. But she composed a poem and sent it to me in the hope that I would read it, and I promised her that I would. Cora Seely is her name, and she and Aunt Mel's have been close for many, many, many years. And on hearing that her good friend had passed on, this is what Cora put together. The title is Remembering My Friend Mel's. My friend Mel's was meticulous as could be. That is how I will always remember her, you see. Everything just had to be in the right place. Otherwise, I was sure it would be corrected with his. She was also very hospitable in every way and always made sure you enjoyed your stay. Very often I visited with her for long periods of time. She would always make sure that everything was fine. In our recent conversations, she would always say to me, "Cora, I would like to see you. How soon can it be? I really want to see you too, more than you can tell. But COVID got in the way, and old age is not treating me well." Nelly, my sister in Canada, introduced Mel's to me. She was her friend before I met Mel's, you see. Both of us regret that neither one of us is there, but memories of her we will always hold dear. I'm hoping that we will meet again in that land where there is no more pain. There will be no sickness, sorrow, parting, or tears. Only love, joy, peace, health, and happiness throughout the years. That's from Cora City, Aunt Mel's dear friend. Thank you, Cora. And now, I want to move on to talking about my Aunt Mel's. Some of you may or may not know, but my mother gave me to her when I was 2 years old. Not in a bad way, but because she thought that Aunt Mel's would do a great job with me, and she did. But that doesn't mean my mother was out of my life. She was still in my life every day. As I tell people all the time, I must have been the only elementary school kid who got a home-cooked meal every day. My mother came to see me at school every day, although my aunt was raising me, my aunt and my grandmother. I'm truly honored to share with you a few stories about my wonderful Aunt Mel's. Aunt Mel's was amazing. She spent her life caring for others. She would often go out of her way to reach those who were in need. She was very kind, generous, always giving of herself warmly and generously. She lived a long, happy life. She made an impact on the world around her, spreading warmth and kindness everywhere that she went. I'm sure that many of us here today have very fond memories of my Aunt Mel's. There was no limit to her selflessness or her generosity or her kindness. You may not be aware of this, but Aunt Mel's was a fully trained dental technician. My father sent her to school in New York, but she never worked at it. Again, her selfless, always willing, always looking to help nature took over. My father needed help with the brownstones in Harlem, and she dedicated, at that time, her life to just helping him, rather than pursue a career as a dental technician. Today, a dental technician is called a dental hygienist, and they probably make enormous sums of money. She could have been that. But she chose to help my father and spent the rest of her life doing that. She and my grandmother, Bertie, raised me from around 2 years old, as I said. They showered me with love, affection, attention, guidance that can only be imagined. As I stand here this morning, I can't help but reflect on what they contributed to my upbringing. Ever so often you hear the term, life has gone full circle. My presence here this morning validates that unequivocally. As a little boy, somewhere between the ages of 7 and 13, I was an active participant in this church, Bethel. I grew up here. I participated in the Easter, harvest, and delivered what was then referred to as recitations. Today they call it elocution. Mom and Aunt Mel's were the architects of my participation. They insisted that I be a part of it. It was mandatory. And of course, Aunt Mel's was my diction coach. So if you like how I sung and you like what I'm saying, my Aunt Mel's did that. I can hear her now as though it was yesterday. You have to speak louder. Your voice has to reach the back row of the church, over and over again. In 1997, at my grandmother's funeral, I delivered her eulogy from right here. And then in 2010, I did a eulogy for my father from right here. And today, I am again very proud, very humble, that I can do this tribute to my Aunt Mel's. But I can't help but wonder, and maybe you can too, wonder, do you think that that was Aunt Mel's grand plan for me? I was a very obedient child. Aunt Mel's and Mom never resorted to corporal punishment. Whatever they told me to do, I did. They scolded me with very strong language, and they never had to say it twice, and they never had to raise the hand to hit me. They both had an overwhelming love for me. The story I'm going to share with you is a real good example. It paints a perfect picture of their feelings for me at around 10 years old, which is the same feelings they carried throughout my entire life. Of course, it's the standard practice for Bajan parents to see that their children are well educated. My parents were no different. Aunt Mel's and Mom and my father wanted the very best for me. So they had enrolled me on what they call private lessons. Tuition with a private tutor, and I would go on Saturday mornings to these lessons. I'd been doing really, really well. My grades were good and everything. But one of my friends, he's now, believe it or not, he's now an officer in the Salvation Army. But at that time, my age group, and we were buddies. So he said to me, "Let's go," because he had been doing it. So he said to me, "Let's go to the Plaza Theater," which was right behind me, 9 o'clock on Saturday mornings to see cowboy movies. Now it's called Westerns, but he said cowboy movies. So I was a little bit reluctant because I'd never disobeyed my parents before, but he kept on, and my age group can be pretty convincing. So we went to these movies, and first thing that happened is I liked it and got caught up in it. So now, every Saturday, instead of going to my tuition classes, I would go right across here to the Plaza, 9 o'clock on a Saturday morning, to watch cowboy movies. Eventually, it dawned on me, as young as I was, that at some point I'm going to have to be accountable for this. So what I did, when they gave me the tuition money, I had a secret place in the house where I kept it. I figured that I was building my defense if I got caught. So I figured if I got caught and I have the money, then the punishment might not be severe. It's a childhood logic, and that's what I had. So sure enough, I've been going to these movies now every Saturday morning, and the tutor hadn't seen me. And it was just, I guess, God's doing that he ran into Marcus's father. He ran into his father, Uncle Ren. And he said to Uncle Ren, "We haven't seen Merv for a couple months." So Uncle Ren, of course, said, "He's supposed to be going every Saturday." So, of course, once Uncle Ren got home, he told my grandmother, and he told Aunt Mills, and he told my father. Well, I wasn't there to see my father's reaction, but based on what Aunt Mills and my grandmother relayed to me later, it wasn't a nice one. What he did was, some of us can understand about this. He went to a tamarind tree and he cut a tamarind off. Ironically, he put the rod by the back door, and it was such a solid rod, it stood up straight. So once you come into the house, you had to see it. So I came home from school, and I head to the kitchen area, and there in the back door was this tamarind rod. I'd never seen any of this before. Aunt Mills and Mom never laid a hand on me. And my father had never laid his hand on me. So I didn't pay much attention to it. So then Mom and Aunt Mel said, "Well, what did you do?" I said, "I didn't do anything." They said, "Well, you were supposed to be at Posse Lane's on Saturday mornings doing your private lessons." So I knew the game was up. I knew I was caught. So I rushed into my secret place, brought my money out, and I said, "Look, I didn't spend any of the money." What a defense. I would learn later that that didn't carry any weight at all. But it was a childish thing I did. So Mom said that, so then I saw Mom's eyes going to the tambourine rod. So mine keep going to it too. So, as young as I was, things started to add up. I knew I was going to get it, so I started shaking like a leaf. And guess what? The kind of love that they have for me, they're crying. A blow hasn't even been thrown yet, and they're crying. And they're not even getting a lunch. I am the one. And they're crying. So that made me more and more fearful, more and more fearful, and I shook more and more. Well, I had no strategy left. I didn't know what to do. So I started conditioning my mind to take it like a man. So it was still difficult. So I left, and I went out to hang out with the boys from my neighborhood. What you got to understand about that is this. Aunt Mills and Mom never allowed me to hang out with the boys from my neighborhood. So now the bigger boys see me, and they, very cruel, they say, "What are you doing here? Your parents don't allow you." So it's coming up to 7, 8 o'clock at night. It's getting dark, and I'm still out there. The crowd is thinning. Then I felt a hand on my shoulder. It was my father. So he didn't say anything. From my shoulder, he held my hand, brought me home, and he lambasted me. I took the full brunt of that tamarind rod. It was the first and only time my father had ever laid a hand on me. But of course, Aunt Mel's and Mama crying all the time. So my father said, "I don't want you ever to work as hard as I did. You gotta be something. You gotta learn something." So So I absorb it as best I could at that age. But my shirt stuck to my back from the tambourine rod lashes. So I slept that night. And remember I mentioned that my mother brought me lunch every day, a cooked meal? So next day at school, my mother brought the cooked meal. And as is her fashion, as she's wont to do, she's checking my skin, she's rubbing me up. Everything has to be perfect for her. But each time she touched my back, I went like this, because my vest and shirt were stuck to the blood in my back. So she said, what caused this? What happened? So I told her in my feeble voice, what happened? And she went crazy. So it was for my good anyway. But I mentioned that story because I think that pretty much tells the degree of love that Aunt Nels and my grandmother had for me. They were not the ones getting the lashes, yet they were the ones who were crying. And that stood with me all my whole life. And I think that defines love between people, between relatives, how you feel about someone. The fact that you're not getting the punishment, somebody else is, but it's hurting you. So my Aunt Mel's was super. I'd like to take this chance to express my family's sincere appreciation and never-ending thanks go out to all those friends whose caring and thoughtfulness over many years were constant help. Merton Moore and family, thanks for over 50 years of the personal attentiveness and everything you continue to do. Max, Racine, Leonard, thanks for all you did and for what you're still doing. Pat and Jean, thanks for sharing your home and hospitality with her whenever you're in town. And most of all, thanks for the phone calls from faraway places. Tony and Shirley, Charlie and Marlene, thanks for always stopping by and sharing a chat or running an errand. Our family will forever be grateful. Aunt Mel's sweet memories fill me anytime I remember advice you found pleasure in sharing with us, and it will always, always be cherished. Your benevolent smile lifted our hearts anytime you were near us. The twinkle in your eyes was always encouragement, and your wisdom for solving complex issues was always admired. And today, we can probably say that you left footprints in the sands of time. Thank you for your everlasting wisdom and all the wonderful memories you gave us. They will always be cherished. Sadly, we've lost a precious jewel. If death were stoppable, I would have kept it from coming your way. Aunt Mel's, we'll always have you in our thoughts. If tears could build a stairway and memories a lane, I'd walk right up to heaven and bring you home again. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Hallelujah.
Good morning, Reverend Dr. Brathwaite and other church officials. Welcome, relatives and friends. On this sad occasion, we have met to say a formal goodbye to a person who has touched our lives in different ways over many years. Indeed, some of us have been touched more deeply than others, but we all have compelling reasons to be here, and to some extent, these reasons must impact us to different degrees. I got to know this lady in the first quarter of 1971, when my wife, Anita, went to work at India House on Broad Street, where Mel's, as she has been affectionately known, was employed. They immediately struck up a friendly relationship to the extent that Mel's took us home to meet her mother, Alberta, popularly known as Bertie. Within a few years, Mel's left for New York, where she joined her brother, Mervyn, and other relatives, including her nephew, Mervyn. The relationship that Mel's started between our two families, rather than weakening with her departure, became stronger, for Bertie was aging at that time, and we saw no reason why we should not have been able to offer any assistance possible. This relationship was to take a step forward when in 1983 my family of four, including our two sons, Matthew and Marlon, had reason to visit New York, upon which Mel's unreservedly said, "We should stay with her." It is there that we met the Mervyns and other relatives, as well as several friends. We soon discovered that Mel's was a person who had several friends. Prominent among them was her childhood friend, Muriel Cadogan. Muriel traveled extensively living in the UK and USA, but always remained close to Mel's and always espousing advice. These friends were scattered throughout Barbados, United States, Canada, and Trinidad, where she also had close relatives, including an uncle, Cam, who is now with, and nieces, including Uncle Cam and nieces. Uncle Cam made the century before passing on, before Mel's, who fell 2 years short, or 2 birthdays short of the century. During our visit to New York, she was always kind and attentive to our needs and desires. She did not allow us to sit idly by, but when necessary, got on the bus or train and took us around, whether it was simply for the drive or to shop. We returned to Barbados heavily laden. Of course, the two Mervyns immediately seemed to believe that they had an obligation to be there for the friends of Mel's. The more than 4 decades that followed speak volumes for this relationship. Based on what we saw, not only in the United States, but also in Barbados and Trinidad, Mel's enjoyed a wonderful life. Even though Mel's did not go out to work on a formal basis, her brother Mervyn and her nephew took such great care of her. It is fair to say that they did not only provide the basic necessities for her, but also goods and services that were, if not needs, they were luxury. She was well clothed, well fed, well housed, and to some extent allowed to call the shots. I believe that I may be correct in saying that from my observation, they either kept quiet or took a step backwards if attempting to do something with which Mills did not agree. It is here in there in New York where I met other relatives like nieces like Sheila, Carol, and Melanie. These are three nice girls or ladies whom I have reason to believe have shown love and regard for Mills. But I have had a closer relationship with Melanie, whom I can describe as a vibrant angel. Vibrant because she's not only nice, she's very active and strong. Mels was also fortunate that her brother Mervyn, with whom she resided in New York, was married to a genuine and demure lady, Iris, and they got along well. Iris never seemed to have any misgivings about the relationship with her brother. As Iris aged and got closer to the century, she expressed the desire that Mills would visit her in Atlanta, Georgia. However, they did not get the opportunity to celebrate Iris' 100th birthday together last May because of COVID. Regrettably, Mills couldn't make the trip to Atlanta. I have also had the pleasure of being in Trinidad with Mills, as well as being in St. Lucia. In St. Lucia, after retiring from the service here in Barbados, went to work in St. Lucia. And the first visitors I had in Trinidad and St. Lucia, Mels and my wife Nita, got on to an aircraft a few days after I arrived there to ensure that I settled in properly. And they sorted out the house how it should be, not having that confidence in me. In Trinidad, Mels had two loving nieces, Gladys and Kathleen, who, once we got to know them, we immediately appreciated that they were blessed with pleasant and kind personalities. They regarded their aunt with love and respect. These two ladies also have children who showed love and kindness to us. In 1980, I had cause to be staying at the Hilton Hotel in Trinidad, and I called Kathleen to say hello, and that resulted in her sending her daughter, Michelle, to me with breakfast. These instances no doubt helped to cement our families, and even though Mels has gone the cemented bond remains between us. Based on the more than 50 years that I have known this family, it is my conviction that Mels came from a caring family. As her mother aged through the 80s and needed assistance, my wife and I would try to assist as much as possible. We would take her places and assisted her with her shopping. And when I had to leave Barbados in 1991 for an official purpose, her granddaughter Kathleen came from Trinidad to Barbados, and with the approval of the Mervyns and Mels, placed her in a home. This further underlines the caring approach of this family. Over the years, I could not help but be moved at the meticulous manner in which Mels approached her domestic duties. She was a good person who left no stone unturned. She ensured that every bill was paid on time and then proceeded to file them properly and in order of months. Before COVID, she would get out to pay her bills, taxes, and insurance prior to the due dates. In addition, her furniture had to be kept in immaculate shape, and once they were not in desirable state, they were changed. Mel's has been the most meticulous record keeper at a domestic level that I have ever met. She made note of the birthdays, marriage dates, telephone numbers of friends and relatives. She also ensured that the customary cards of greetings and celebration were sent out in a timely manner. And in the case of children, there was always a monetary gift included. Mel's loved a lot of good clothing and adornments. Mel's always tried to be prim and proper, and no doubt scorned the appearance of being old. This can be supported by the fact that in the last few years of her life, she would get her hair barbered and then have a color added to hide any semblance of gray. A few days before leaving the hospital, she told Madge that she would get the barber to come and cut the hair and then ask Madge to put the color in. Madge reminded her that she had good, beautiful hair and did not need any color, but Mel's comforted that Mervyn knew that she did not like any gray hair and he would not put her in the ground with white hair. Mel's was extremely refined to the extent that even in her 90s, she still wore ankle bracelets on some occasions. Mel's never got old. Indeed, for her, age was just a number. She always reminded me that jokingly that her mother Bertie never passed the age of 40. And so when Bertie's younger brother visited her in the elderly home, and was asked how old he was, and he replied 76. Bertie retorted that was not true because she had not yet reached that there. But not only did Mel's love beautiful clothing and quality goods, she enjoyed foods to compare. Mel's loved Kentucky and Chefet. And even though I was the driver, she would normally take me at least once per month for fast foods, some of which would be taken home. Mel's knew her friends. She knew their likes and dislikes. She knew that Tony, her childhood friend Muriel's son, and I liked Coca-Cola. And she always ensured that she had some in stock and in the refrigerator. There was a time when we enjoyed Jamaican ginger wine, and that was always kept in stock. Mel's was predeceased by her older brother, Mervyn Ashby, and younger brother, Dennis Bryan. She is survived by her sister-in-law, Iris Ashby, Georgia, USA, aunt-in-law, Yvonne Hawksworth, and Gasparilla, Trinidad, nephew, Mervyn Hoare, and wife Jenny in New York, nephew Marcus Bryan in London, nieces Gladys Wells, Kathleen Turner in New York, Sheila Schultz in Chicago, Rosemary Greenwich in Barbados, Carol Ashby and Melanie Lewis in Georgia, Cheryl Bryan, Cree Bryan, Lauren Bryan in London. Mel's was bountifully blessed with over 30 grand nieces and nephews, a host of great, great grand nieces and nephews, and several great, great grand nieces and nephews, too numerous to mention individually. And the grandmother, Beverly Hollingsworth, and Paul, granddaughter, Beverly Hollingsworth, and Paul Jones. She was a dear friend of Merton and Anita Moore, Marlon, Anthony, and Shirley Cadella, Leonard, Madge, Racine, and Caleb Trotman, Pat Moore, Jean Francis, Egerton Clark, Melva Williams, David and Ronald, Roger Gill, Arthur and Cynthia Service, Edwin and Marlene Cumberbatch. Rosita Holligan, Monica, Marie, Patricia, and Julie Bryan, Marina Leacock, and the entire Jones family, Warren Seeley, and numerous neighbors, Samuel and David Harewood. In closing, I am in a position to say that Mel's enjoyed a wonderful life. Mel's possessed elite clothing. She got good food. She lived in good, comfortable houses, both in Barbados and New York. She was able to travel widely and was shown love and respect from members of a loving family. Her warmth, deep caring, and regard for the people in her life was always readily displayed. May she rest in peace.
We bless God and thank all of those who paid tribute to our sister Virginia Imelda Bryan, the tribute from her adopted son Mervyn, the solo by Shanika Roach so often. We concern ourselves with our young people and if all the things that were of the olden days would go, but I'm so very happy for that beautiful rendition by Shanika Roach, who continues to keep that beautiful religious music made so long ago alive. Thank you, Shanika. Well done. And we also want to say thank you to Merton Moore, who did the eulogy, and it's amazing. I don't know the last day I saw such a complete order of service with the eulogy printed and all of that. It used to be, but I'm very grateful today that we can look again at the past and honor Sister Mel's meticulous nature, because indeed it is meticulously done. As we continue to celebrate her life and witness, we sing the hymn 396, Glorious Things of You Are Spoken, Zion City of Our God. Thank you. We now turn our attention to the Word of God. We invite our readers to come and share with us. Psalm 121 will be read by Beverly Hollingsworth. Our epistle reading, 1 Corinthians chapter 13, 1 to 4, and 8 to 13 by Carol Ashby. Our gospel reading, John 14, 1 to 6 and 27 by Anita Moore. And during the singing of the hymn 188, "And Can It Be That I Should Gain," there will be a collection for the Restoration Fund. This was not previously included, but when the family saw that we actually had on our form that we were collecting for the restoration of this beautiful chapel, they have asked that we allow them to honor us by receiving that collection. So we will receive that collection while we sing the hymn 188. So Beverly, Carol, and Anita, you may follow one another for the reading of the scriptures.
He will not suffer thy foot to be moved. He that keepeth thee will not slumber. Behold, he that keepeth Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is thy keeper. The Lord is thy shade upon thy right hand. The sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve thee from all evil. He shall preserve thy soul. The Lord shall preserve thy going out and thy coming in from this time forth and even forevermore.
Amen.
I just want to say a couple of things about Aunt Mel's. She was a sweet spirit. She was humble, she was a caregiver, and she was very loyal to her family. And she never forgot a birthday. Okay, I'm going to read from Corinthians 13. If I speak in the tongues of men or of angels, but do not have love, I am only a sounding or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of a prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient, love is kind. Love does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud, it does not dishonor others, it is not self-seeking, it is not easily angered, it keeps no record of wrongs. Love never fails, but where there is prophecies, there will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when completeness comes, what is in part disappears. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. But when I became a man, I put the ways of childhood behind me. For now we see only a reflection as a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. And now these three remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of all these things is love. And our milk was love.
All right. Please stand for the reading of the gospel.
Micaiah could not be here this morning with us, so I'm filling in for him. The gospel is taken from St. John's chapter 14. Reading from verse 1 to 6 and at verse 37. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. And whither I go, ye know, and the way ye know. Thomas said unto him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way? Jesus said unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Not as the world I give unto you, not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Yeah, I'm going to collect the offer.
Yeah, we're going to go down.
We receive an offering for the collection for the restoration fund as we sing the hymn 188. And can it be that I should gain an interest in the Savior's blood? Died he for me who caused his pain, for me to him who death pursued.
Thank you.
It is always good. It is always good to give thanks to the Lord, and so we thank Him for the gifts of money which we have received. Let us pray. O God and our Heavenly Father, we give you thanks and praise for every opportunity to ensure that your work continues here on earth. Indeed, Lord, there are so many who need to know of your love and care. And so, Lord, as we continue to celebrate the life of our sister, we remember her work and her witness in this Bethel Church, and the care that she made to ensure that her loved ones also received that spiritual wholeness. And so, Lord, we lift these gifts in honor of this building. We pray, oh God, that you will bless these gifts and bless us all as we commit to ensuring that your kingdom continues to come as we minister in this building. So bless these gifts and bless us all together. For Christ's sake, amen. On behalf of the Bethel Methodist Church, and indeed on behalf of the many Methodist churches that our sister would have visited and her family as they traversed the Caribbean, and indeed the other places that they would have visited and lived, we want to extend our deepest condolences and sympathies to the family and loved ones gathered here in this sanctuary. It is wonderful to see so many persons coming to share in the life and remembrance of our dear sister Virginia Imelda Bryan. And so we offer to you the living word of God, something that you know well and something that our sister lived by. And we ask that God will continue to hold you in his loving arms and keep you in his care. We pray that the memory of our sister will live on, and that those fond memories will give you that comfort and support you need. And of course, we know that our God has promised that in these times of mourning, he will never leave us nor forsake us. And he has promised that he will comfort and support you. Indeed, he says, "Behold, I hold you in the palm of my hands." And so, my brothers and sisters, today, be assured that God is walking this journey with you. Grief is never easy, and we go through so many feelings and emotions. But today, we are so grateful that the love of our sister, Virginia Imelda Bryan, is foremost in your heart, and so you hold on. I encourage you to hold on to that love and allow those loving memories to continue to take you through this time of separation. So may God continue to bless you and keep you in his care as you continue to say farewell to our dear sister. Let us pray. God and our Heavenly Father, how wonderful you are. You know all about us, and so we lift the family and friends of our dear sister Imelda, who has gone home, lovingly known as Mel, Lord. We pray that you will continue to minister to their every need. We pray, Lord, that you will touch them with your loving hands. May they feel and know your presence, Lord. And even as the tears flow, may they know that you are wiping those tears away from their eyes. I pray, oh God, that you will strengthen them and give them the support they need, so that even as they hear the word today, they may be comforted and reassured that you are with them walking this journey of separation. So breathe your words into their hearts today, Lord, and give them, oh Lord, the understanding and the wisdom so that they will be able to hold fast all that you say and speak into their hearts, so that indeed they may find that assurance of your comfort and your love present with them today, even as they continue to remember their loved one, Imelda. So bless them, Lord, and give them your constant care. You said we should cast all our cares upon you because you care for us. And so, Lord, I pray that they will experience it in a very special way today as they say farewell.
So, Lord, breathe your words again into our hearts. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray with thanksgiving. Amen. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, entitled from the New Revised Standard Version, the updated edition, it is entitled The Gift of Love. And indeed, as we listened and hear the tributes to our dear sister, Virginia Imelda Bryan, better known as Mels and Aunt Mels, we really come to know what love is. And we recognize that this love, even though it has earthly traits, is truly birthed in the love of God. And it is this love that God has given to all human beings so that we can experience life in all its fullness. And indeed, as we heard of the many warm memories and stories of our sister Imelda, we can ascertain that this gift of love was in her life, and I pray that it will continue to be in the lives of those who are celebrating her today. This is a very powerful text, one that is used not only at funerals, but also at weddings. And indeed, in every good celebration of life where we have recognized that love of God living in us, we who are human beings, who are always trying to attain to this love. And so this book and this chapter reminds us that in order to attain it, we need to be guided by the principles of God. We're reminded that if we speak in tongues of humans and of angels, but do not have love, we are a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And even though we might be able to foretell what is going to happen in life, even though, as is recorded in 2 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 9, God has made us aware of the mysteries of life, if we do not use that understanding with knowledge, that wisdom that He has given us, if we do not use it with knowledge, then we are just wasting our time. And it goes on to say, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but do not love, I am nothing. So in other words, my brothers and sisters, the love of God is the prime ingredient if we are to live true and perfect lives. Indeed, Nehemiah reminds us that the steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His love for us never comes to an end. That love is new every morning. And my quotation is from Lamentations, book written by Jeremiah and not Nehemiah. I give so we recognize that God's love is unending. And verse 8 of this passage of scripture reminds us of that as well. Love never ends. So if we are truly in love with God, then we recognize that our love for our human fellows never ends. It reminds us that it does not have anything to do with our possessions, how much we have. But it is an unconditional love. So we give and give and give again, even though that love or that giving might not be reciprocated. Even though we might never receive from the hands that we have given to, we do not stop giving. We do not stop loving. Indeed, the story is told of Mervyn having been living with our sister, and how even though she lived with him, his mother and herself didn't seem to get along. But in the later days, that was all mended, and that love that seemed that it would never happen started to happen as they grew close together in their old age and indeed recognized that they could not spend the day without making sure that they were in contact with each other. And so, my brothers and sisters, we see that love that continues to reach out to each other, even though we may have our differences, even though things may happen in our lives that cause us to separate. Those things do not stop us from sharing that love and giving that love and always seeking that love so that wrongs are made right. And so our scripture today reminds us of the truth about what love is. It reminds us that love is patient. It reminds us that love is kind, that it is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It reminds us that it does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable. It keeps no record of wrongs. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. And indeed, we saw it again when Mervyn spoke of the insistence of doing the right thing and walking in the right way. That kept him going, and beloved, that is what keeps us going, especially when we know that it is the love of God shed abroad in our hearts that keeps us focused. So many in the world today do not understand that goodness of God and that love that can keep us living well and being strong. Our sister not only lived her life for her family, but she was well positioned in society. She made sure that she gave herself to organizations like self-help that were there to help others. She made sure that she came to this Bethel Methodist Church and that she allowed her life to be covered and blessed and supported by a life in God. Too many of us these days think that it is only food and drink and work that we should attain to. But our sister's life reminds us that that we live a whole life, that we are physical, we are spiritual, we are emotional, we are psychological, we are social, and she lived everything and put everything into place. And so, my brothers and sisters, we are challenged today, especially in these times when we see so much that is going wrong, when we see so much things that can break our faith and cause us to doubt. We need to stand on that understanding that God's love must be lived out in our lives. And so, to live out that love of God, we too need to be examples of that love. Indeed, one songwriter said, love is not a noun, it is a verb. You can say it as often as you like, but when you show it in your actions, you are forever blessed. And we saw that our sister was blessed to a ripe old age of 98, just missing her 99th birthday by a couple of days. Her love for family, whenever they visited her and whenever she visited them in Trinidad, London, Canada, USA, was always there. She was always hospitable, always taking care of them. As a matter of fact, where her family is and was, she was most at home. And so you can recognize that bond and that pull, that love and friendship, that agape love, and not only agape, but filial, and all the other kinds of love that keep us grounded, making sure that we are well served and we serve people well because of that love of God dwelling in our hearts. Our sister enjoyed life. They even here this morning, you can see how her warmth impacted you who have come to celebrate her, her friendliness. We heard over and over again her how she was given to hospitality, never forgot a birthday, never forgot a celebration, how meticulous she was about life, and how she made sure that everyone around her received the comfort and support that was necessary to keep that love, that familial love and that God love growing inside of each and every one that our sister met. One of the things that was spoken of by her son Mervyn is that she enjoyed life, and he ended by saying she had a good life. And I found it so interesting that he and his wife mentioned that she was never sick, and it was only 3 months before death for her death, before her death, that she really was ill. And most distinctively, not only that she died in peace, but the birth of a grand niece in London was experienced within an hour of her death. And I believe that what was being said here is that the family heritage goes on. Even as she passes, she has passed on the baton to the younger members of her family. That baton of love. So that the family, as it grows and becomes stronger for her experiences in their lives and her witness to them and her example that she has set, they have found and was bold to say that they believe that the legacy will go on in the younger generation and even in this grandniece who was born so closely after her death. They also reminded me, and is reminding us today, that when we are away from the body, we are at peace with the Lord. And so the fact that our sister died peaceably shows that she had made her peace with the Lord, and that the commitment that she had made to life and God was now over, and now she could receive her blessings. And I don't know if they remember, but they also mentioned this hymn, which I will close with, this song, written by Doyle Lawson, "When You Reach the End of the Road," the end of the road, it is entitled. It says, "When I come to the end of the long, long road, the shadows will flee away, and I'll stand in the glorious light of God, where dwelleth eternal day." And the chorus says, "When I come to the end of the road, to the land of eternity, when I come to the end of life's long road, the face of my Lord I'll see." We're still looking back over the years that were hard and drear. "The hand of the Christ I'll see, and my heart will go forth with a song of praise because of his love for me." And verse 3 says, "When I come to the end of the long, long road, the trials will all be past, and I look on the face of my dearest friend, safe home in heaven at last." Our sister lived a full life. She enjoyed her life. She remembered to praise God and gave him his worth. We are so appreciated this morning that the family remembers this church. And even though it was not on the original order, they decided that they would collect some funds for our restoration of this building. And we are so grateful because we, who have been challenged in our motto as Methodists to keep going. Our motto says from Colossians, "The love of Christ constrains us." And so we are constrained to continue this love of God. It forces us to tell this message of salvation. We are so pleased this morning when others recognize that God is foremost in our lives and His work and ministry must continue as we shed this gospel. My brothers and sisters, indeed, Aunt Mel's, Virginia, Imelda, Brian, Mel's lived her life to the fullest and she understood what it was to live a full and whole life, a life committed to the service of God and a life committed to the service of family and friend and stranger. And so we bless God today for her. We bless God for the example that she has left for us. And we encourage each other along that road of love. That love that forgives. That love that ensures that things are always in place so that we can care for each other. And more than ever, as we see the wars and diseases and all the other things that challenge our lives, I want to encourage us today to let that gift of love be the legacy that you continue that we saw in our sisters' lives. And so, my brothers and sisters, I too today offer you that gift of love, the love of God that dwells strong in our hearts, that love that is unconditional and that never leaves us, that love that challenges us to do all we can, by all the means we can, for as long as ever we can, so that we can remind people that this life is worth the living, and so that when we come to the end of the road, there will be no regrets. All there will be to remember us is that life that shows forth in our hearts, even as you remember our sister with that dearest love that she gave to you. I thank God that her love was grounded in Jesus, and I encourage you today not only to live life and enjoy the pleasures, but remember that those pleasures are given to us by God, and give Him the honor and glory that is due to His name as our sister did. Once again, I want to extend my sympathies and best regards to the family and friends gathered here, and I pray that as you continue to feel all the emotions that this separation brings to you, the tears, the sadness, the hurt, the pain, and even sometimes the brokenheartedness that stays with us for a while, that you will know that even as our sister endured and enjoyed this life, she endured and enjoyed it trusting God. And so I offer you this God, not that you will trust Him too, to take you along this journey of separation. I pray it in the name of Jesus Christ with thanksgiving. Amen. Let us pray. God and our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the life and witness of our sister Imelda. We place all those who are mourning in your hands today. We ask, O Lord, that even as she gave that example of love, that they will hold fast to that example that was birth in you and through you. And so I pray, Lord, that they too will experience your love and your care at this time. So bless them, Lord. Continue to comfort and support them. May they feel and know your love and encouragement and draw close to you even as you draw close to them. We pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ with thanksgiving. Amen. Even as we reflect on the blessing of having God in our lives, we stand and say the Apostles' Creed together, reminding ourselves that we do believe in a God who is able, who is our creator of heaven and earth, and in His Son, who is our Savior, and the power of the Holy Spirit which guides us through our lives. Let us stand as we repeat the Apostles' Creed together. I believe in God, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you. We continue with our prayers of thanksgiving. Praise be to you, O God our Father, who created us in your own image for eternal fellowship with you. Praise and thanksgiving to you, O Christ, our Lord and our God, who have overcome the sharpness of death and opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers and are now seated at the right hand of God in the glory of the Father. Praise and blessing be to you, O Holy Spirit, God our Comforter, who bear witness within us of our acceptance with the Father and have become the pledge of our eternal inheritance. All praise and glory, blessing and honor, thanksgiving and worship be to you, O Blessed Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. We bless your name for the life of her whom we today lay to rest. We give you thanks for the joy and the blessing her life has brought to others, for her service to her generation according to your will, and for every happy remembrance of her life. We bless you for your mercy and goodness which have followed her all the days of her life, that now the trials of this world are over and death itself is past. Receive her into your perfect kingdom, and bring us with all who have lived and served you faithfully to the fullness of your eternal joy through Jesus Christ, our Lord. The Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The commendation, eternal God, who have made us all and hate nothing that you have made, and have given your Son for our redemption, we commend our sister Virginia Imelda to your perfect mercy and wisdom. Eternal rest grant unto her, and let perpetual light shine upon her. We close this part of our service by singing, O Love That Will Not Let Me Go, hymn 262. O Love That Will Not Let Me Go, I rest my weary soul in thee. I give thee back the life I owe, that in thine ocean depths its flow may richer full of thee.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
it right on it. The committal. We know that neither death, nor life, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature can separate us from the love of God, which is in Jesus Christ, our Lord. We know that if this earthly house of our tabernacle be dissolved, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. Since our sister Virginia Imelda has departed out of this life, and Almighty God in His mercy has taken her to Himself, we therefore commit her body to the ground. Dust to dust, ashes to ashes, earth to earth, in sure and certain hope of the resurrection to eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, from henceforth blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. Even so says the Spirit, for the rest from their labors. Let us pray. O merciful God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, Father of mercies and God of all comfort, raise us up, we pray, from death of sin to the new life of righteousness, that when we shall depart this life, we shall be found acceptable in your sight. This we pray through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Grant to the bereaved consolation and faith in this time of distress and trial, the blessed hope in the coming of your kingdom, the sustaining grace in the fellowship of your people, and steadfastness in the service of your name, and the doing of your will, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Support us, O Lord, all the day long of this troublous life, until the shadows lengthen, the evening comes, the busy world is hushed, the fever of life is over, and our work is done. Then, Lord, in your mercy, grant unto us safe lodging, holy rest, and peace at the last, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We sing the hymn, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood.
Yeah, the music is coming.
Oh, what a fortress of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, visions of rapture now burst on my side. Angels descending, ring from above. Echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my
blessed assurance, Jesus is mine.
Start over.
My Savior, all the day long.
challenging scenes of life in trouble and in joy, the praises of my God shall still my heart and tongue employ. We will sing, "It is well with my soul, it is well with my soul." The changing scenes of life in trouble and in joy. Let us pray. The blessing of God Almighty, Father and Son and Holy Spirit be with you all now and forevermore. Amen. May the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all now and forevermore. Amen. Once again, the Bethel Methodist Church and associated churches extend sympathy to our family. We wish you all the best as you go through this period of separation. But we know that God will help you and that He will continue to encourage you as you encourage each other. Blessings on you all.
Goodbye.